Welcome, Church, to Sunday School. My name is Karis Asi, and I am your service leader for today. Our song of adoration is Onward Christian Soldiers.
For today is Faithful Stewards, and our preacher is Dr. Irene Akwaku. Shall we pray? Father Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for waking us up this morning. Father Lord, as we are here to listen to your word, please open our minds to be able to accept what you are going to give to us and help us to be able to practice whatever you teach us today in our lives. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. The Lord's Prayer.
Father, which art in heaven, hallowed guard their doors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory
The scripture reading. Our first scripture reading is taken from Judges chapter 4, verse 1 to 10. Judges chapter 4, verse 1 to 10. Again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord, now that Ithad was dead. So the Lord sold them into the hands of Jabin, king of Canaan, who reigned in Hazor. Sisera, the commander of his army, was based in Haroseth Hagoyim, because he had 900 chariots fitted with iron and had cruelly oppressed the Israelites for 20 years. They cried to the Lord for help. Now Deborah, a prophet, the wife of Lapidoth, was leading Israel at that time. She had held court under the palm of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in the hill country of Ephraim, and the Israelites went up to her to have their disputes decided. She sent for Barak, son of Abinoam, from Kedesh in Naphtali, and said to him, "The Lord, the God of Israel, commands you, go, take with you 10,000 men of Naphtali and Zebulun, and lead them to Mount Tabor. I will lead Sisera, the commander of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his troops to the river Kishon, and give them into your hands." Barak said to her, "If you go with me, I will go with you. If you don't go with me, I won't go." "Certainly, I will go with you," said Deborah, "but because of the course you are taking, the honor will not be yours. For the Lord will deliver Sisera into the hands of a woman." So Deborah went with Barak to Kedesh. There Barak summoned Zebulun and Naphtali, and 10,000 men went up under his command. Deborah also went up with him. This is the word of God. Our second Bible reading is taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 1 to 11. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 1 to 11, and I read, "Now, brothers and sisters, about times and dates we do not need to write to you, for you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying peace and safety, destruction will come on them suddenly, as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you, brothers and sisters, are not in darkness, so that this day should surprise you like a thief. You are all children of the light and children of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. So then, let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be awake and sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, putting on faith and love as a breastplate, and the hope of salvation as a helmet. For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. He died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. This is the word of God. The gospel reading is taken from Matthew chapter 25, verse 14 to 30. Matthew chapter 25, verse 14 to 30. And I read, "Again, it will be like a man going on a journey, who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. To one, he gave 5 bags of gold, to another, 2 bags, and to another, 1 bag, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 bags more. So also, the one with 2 bags of gold gained 2 bags more. But the man who had received 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. The man with 2 bags of gold also came. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 2 bags of gold. See, I have gained 2 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Then the man who had received 1 bag of gold came. Master, he said, I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seeds. So I was afraid and went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seeds. Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers, so that when I return, I would have received it back with interest. So take the bag of gold from him and give it to the one who has 10 bags. For whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. This is the word of God. We will have the Bible lesson by Dr. Irene Akwaku. Shall we welcome her?
Good morning, church. Good morning, family. Good morning. It's been a while, and I'm so glad I could come by your way again this morning. This morning, we have an interesting topic to discuss. And it's a topic that we all do love because we are familiar with the story, as you probably may have heard from the scripture reading. It is about the parable of the talent. It's about the parable of the talent. Very familiar story. But as we all know, as God will have it, anytime we go back to such familiar stories, he speaks to us again in so many, many ways. So that's my prayer, that God will speak to us even as we go back to this very familiar story this morning. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you. Father, we give you praise and give you adoration for what you've done in our lives all these times through this pandemic, and how you've protected us and how you've healed us and how you've comforted us. Lord, as we go through your word today, we pray that you speak to us in a very special way. Let me just be used as an empty vessel, nothing of myself, but you by your spirit through me would even lead a discussion about our talents. May your name be glorified this morning and into the household and into every place that hears the sound of my voice. May the Spirit of the living God rekindle in the hearts of men. May that Spirit that raised Christ from the dead be renewed in the hearts of people, so that those who are hurting, those who need deliverance, those who need breakthroughs, those who need healings, everything will come, because we still believe in this, in the resurrected power of the Lord. We ask this in the mighty name of Jesus. We pray with thanksgiving. Amen. So our lesson today is titled Faithful Steward. Faithful Steward. So I tried searching the meaning of faithful, and looking at it, words like loyal comes in, words like devotion. So faithfulness or faithful means or implies long, continued, steadfast devotion to whatever one is bound by pledge, duty, or obligation. Like a faithful friend. So you have a friend who stays faithful long. Nothing deters the friend away. So let's keep that in our mind when we are talking about faithfulness. And also the other word that is interesting to look up is steward. So utilizing and managing all resources, okay? God provides for the glory of God and the betterment of his creation. So we are using the resources God has provided, okay? Managing it well, good, for his glory and what? The betterment of his creation. So these are the two words. But our Bible reading today is about the talent, the parable of the talent. And yes, when you go through that parable, there were, or there is one servant that got 10 of the talent, and there's another servant, only 5. Well, there is one, and I'm glad that even from the scriptures, we realize that there is one talent that God wants us to be faithful in and give account. Okay, so let us try and envisage it this way. You're going on a trip, okay, and probably children at home, you identify with it. And then you have a nice toy or even a pet, and you leave it with a friend. You're traveling with mom and dad, and you're like, please keep it for me. When you come back or you get back from the trip, are you not so happy if the friend has kept it so nice, has even made it look good? Let's say it's a dog, has given it a bath, ready for you, smelling good. You'll be so happy. In this parable, in Matthew 25, okay, from verse 14 to 30, that's the same way God expects us to also do to all talents that he's given us. When we look at this verse in 1 Peter 5:4-10, it says that each of you use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. So there are various gifts that God has given us. We all have different gifts. In the church, it's very easy to identify gifts like singing, gifts like preaching, or gifts like counseling, all other gifts. And probably it may not be so identifiable gifts like praying, interceding, because it's done in the closet. But 1 Peter 4:10 urges us that each of you use whatever gift that you have received to serve others as faithful what? Stewards. Remember, stewards, managing, devotion, and utilizing whatever gift God has given us. Okay, whatever gift God has given us. Now, another thing that I realize, even from that story, is that it's not just about keeping these gifts, but it's more about even improving it so that it yields and bear fruits. Remember the one that had 10 talents? Got additional 10. So he didn't just keep it. He improved it and it bore fruits. Just imagine that. We all have talents, but when we come to church and we meet together, we keep it to ourselves. No singing, no preaching, nothing. It will be a very ineffective church. In the same way, we all have talents in our workplaces, in places, and we do not put it to use. Let me just give an example. Look at how when we were locked down with this COVID crisis, and there wasn't football, there were lots of people who missed the Premier League. I know my boys did miss it. But we are watching other people using their talent in the community, in the world. It's the same thing. If you have a talent, we have to put it to good use. And remember, we are supposed to be faithful stewards. Now, Romans 12, verse 6, says we have different gifts according to the grace given to us. If one's gift is prophecy, let him use it in proportion to his faith. Okay? I believe that certain times the difficulty is, what is my talent? What am I gifted in? What can I do? Oh, I can't sing. I can't do that. I can't do this. I can't do that. I think sometimes that's what happens to us. But the popular advice that people could give, and I've come across it, is finding out the thing that you most enjoy doing. You have fun with it, okay? Or you're very comfortable with. Maybe it's writing, okay? Maybe it's some thinking, some form of analytical mind. Whatever it is, God, I believe in his wisdom, has created us and given all of us talents. All of us talents. Christians, everyone on the face of the earth, all of us talent. But one thing I want to even caution about finding something that is comfortable and you love doing is to also remember that although it's comfortable and you love doing it, it is hard work. It can be hard work. And that shouldn't deter you from you realizing that this is actually a gift. And it should be comfortable and I shouldn't work hard to harness it or to develop it. Let's say singing. You still have to go through the lyrics, learn the song, and what do you have to do? You also have to practice for a very long time before you even minister. So yes, you do have a talent. It's comfortable for you to do it, but in developing it, it is hard work. It is hard work. Like we watch the footballers. I like giving that example, right? It's hard work, and those who have been on the pitch playing football, I think sometimes running 15 minutes, your heart will start panting. Yes, so it's hard work. So in the same way, God wants us to develop and improve our gifts. We have by putting it into use. Practice makes one perfect. So the more we put it into use, the more we get to develop it, the more it blesses others, the more we find ways and means of even developing and serving in the church. In the church. Yes, we are talking about talent, but in going through the scripture, there's something that dropped within my spirit. I want us to look at it from that angle. Okay? Let's put the whole that, okay, I can't find my talent. Yes, I can't find my talent. We can put it on hold for now. But there are some things or basic things that God has given us as human beings in this land of the living. And God wants us to be faithful stewards of those things. Faithful stewards of those things. The first thing I want us to talk about is the mind. Each and every one of us, we have a body, right? We have a mind and the spirit, and we live in an environment. But let's skew down and talk about the mind. What are we doing with our minds? Are we being faithful stewards, guarding it such that isn't all kinds of things do not come in there? Negative thoughts, suicidal thoughts, very sad, gloomy things, or insecurities. What is it that we hold up in our minds? God wants us to be faithful stewards of guarding the mind. In Romans 12, verse 2, it says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by the testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. In Proverbs 4, verse 23, it says, guard your heart with all vigilant, for from it flows the springs of life. Okay, this is all about the mind. How are we guarding our mind? How are we being good and faithful stewards about our minds and our mind? 1 Peter 4:7-11. I'll read part of it. It says that the end of the times is at hand. Therefore, be self-controlled. Be self-controlled and sober-minded for the sake of your prayers. Above all, keep loving one another earnestly, since love covers a multitude of sin. God wants us to be sober-minded. So yes, there's this whole idea about talents, but there are these things that God has given us that we are supposed to be faithful stewards of each and every one of them. How are we being faithful in guarding our mind? Are we really renewing it every day so that the thoughts that are on in our minds are thoughts that positively would affect others? Or are they thoughts that when there's an artificial intelligence to read your mind, you wouldn't be happy that someone knows what is going on in your mind? Today, God is speaking to us and God is entreating us. We have our mind and He wants us to be faithful stewards of our mind. Let's guard it and let's guard it well. We also have a body. How are we keeping our body? Remember that the scripture talks about how our body are the temple, or the body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. God dwells in us. So it's not anything that we can do to the body and keep the body. And no, as faithful stewards, God do not want us to do things to the body that even harms the body. 3 John 2, it says that, dear friends, I hope all is well with you and that you are as healthy in body as you are strong in spirit. So we are to take care of the body and take care of it very well. And just like how it also says in this verse about being strong in spirit, we have a spirit. How are we being faithful stewards of the spirit? What are we nurturing the spirit with? And one of the things that I always am reminded of, especially in Sunday school, we have this song, read your Bible, pray every day if you want to grow, and we used to do that. It's a basic principle. If you really want to flourish, be faithful in keeping your spirit as God will want us to. There's nothing else that we have to do than to read our Bible, pray every day, share the word, so that when people come into contact with you, they say, oh, this person has a sweet spirit. Do you know why? Because the person is nurturing. The person is being faithful, managing, utilizing this spirit that God has given him or her, utilizing it well, but not just putting anything in there. There are so many things out that really want space in our mind and in our spirit, and let's say our soul. What we watch, what we read, and so many other things. But we as good stewards and faithful ones, what we have to do is to guard the spirit. Okay? Train yourself. 1 Timothy 4:7 says, train yourself towards godliness, keeping yourself spiritually fit. Spiritually fit. So we are to be faithful stewards of our spirit. Another interesting one which came to mind is our environment and our surroundings. And what are we doing in our own way to be good stewards of our surroundings? I'm always, it always hits me when I'm walking around and I see a lot of polythene bags, rubbers, and all those things all over the place. And each and every one, I just do a soul searching and says, how am I even disposing of mine? Am I reusing it? Am I utilizing it well so that it is not just that I throw it away anyhow or dispose of it? Remember, in Genesis 2:15, the Lord took man, put him in the garden of Eden, to work it and keep it. To do what? Work it and keep it. That is what God did. So we are to be good stewards of our environment as well. Work it and keep it. Work it and keep it. Good. So this is what God wants us to do as Christians. Yes, there's the talent bit. And people normally stay in the world of discovering for a long time. But whilst you're discovering, remember that there are these basic things God has given us that we are supposed to be good stewards of them. Our mind, our body, our spirit, the environment, the earth, where we live, our surroundings, and the people around us. God wants us to be good, faithful stewards with all these things that has been entrusted into us. Okay. So in summary, yes, God wants us to be like the servant who was given 10 or 5 talents, okay, and use it profitably. But remember, he told us about the one who had just one talent. He still wants us to use that one talent, whatever it is that God has given you. So he wants us to put it into good use, not just to bless or to probably have some special gain from it, but it's more as to bless the family, bless the church, bless the community, and bless the world. You know, that is the talents of people that is making us do all these things. Yes, recording this, it's someone's mind, thought, and development, such that now there's this technology. So it's good that if we have talents, or if we have things that we know God has placed in our hearts, so that it will help community, family, society, we put it, we develop it. Hard work, a bit of training here and there, but then it will benefit. But as Christians, our focus is even benefiting the church. And then it will affect the community and it will affect the world as a whole. So I pray that we'll be faithful stewards. God wants us to, not only in the gifts that God has given us, but also in the basic things that God has created and put us in. All the basic things that we have, like our minds, like our bodies, like our spirit, like the environment that we are in. I pray that when God comes back, which in 1 Thessalonians 5, he says that like a thief, we will not be as once in the darkness, but we would be working hard, such that when he comes like a thief in the night, he wouldn't catch us unaware, because we are not ready to give an account. But he would come, and then we would hear that sound or that message that he gave to the servant of 10 and 5 talents. That well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the rest of my Father. May that be our portion. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you all.
This is Kairos, and I am reading Luke chapter 6, verse 38. Luke chapter 6, verse 38. And I read, give to others, and God will give to you. Indeed, you will receive a full measure, a generous helping, poured into your hands, all that you can hold. The measure you use for others is the one that God will use for you. This is the word of God.
Psalm 27, verse 3 to 5. Even if a whole army surrounds me, I will not be afraid. Even if enemies attack me, I will still trust God. I have asked the Lord for one thing. One thing only do I want, to live in the Lord's house all my life, to marvel there at his goodness and to ask for his guidance. In time of trouble, he will shelter me. He will keep me safe in his temple and make me secure on a high rock. Psalm 27, verse 3 to 5.
Luke 19:10. The Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. Luke 19:10. Amen.
1 Corinthians 1:18-19. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I shall destroy the wisdom of the wise, and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. 1 Corinthians 1:18-19.
Shall we pray? Father Lord, we thank you for the word that you give us today. As we are leaving your presence, please make us remember whatever we've learned and help us to apply it into our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. We'll have the benediction.
Unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you blameless before his Father, I commit each and every one of you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May he lift up the light of his countenance and walk you, even if it's through the valley of the shadow of death, and through the paths of teenage and youthfulness and adulthood and even childhood, that he'll bring you to his throne and anoint you and give you his peace both now and always. Amen.
Have a blessed week.